that attitude describe many Christians today? When things get hard, how soon can we come to the end of our resources? How quickly we spend all that we have within ourselves? We can't figure out a way out of the problems and find inner strength for some of those trials. But a time comes when a famine will begin to strike the soul. And you come to the end of yourself. You don't know which way to turn. Your friends can't help you. You're left empty and hurting, and nothing left inside to draw upon. You're spent, and all your fight is gone. And all that's left is fear and depression and emptiness and hopelessness. Are you still hanging around the devil's pig pen? Are you wallowing in emptiness and starving to death? And that is what happened to the prodigal son. There was nothing left in him to draw upon. He had exhausted all of his resources. He realized where all his self-reliance had brought him. But what was it that finally woke him up? It was when he came to himself. It was when he remembered all the abundant provisions in his father's house. He said, I'm starving out here, but in my father's house there's bread enough and to spare. Luke 15 and 17, he decided to go back and appropriate his father's bountiful provisions. You see, the heart of God's love is found in the father's invitation to come and to enjoy a banquet of his provisions. There's not one word in this parable that would indicate that the prodigal son came back because of the love for his father. He was repentant. He fell on his knees. He cried, Father, I'm sorry. I've sinned against you and against God. I'm not even worthy to come into your house. But he never said, Father, I came back because I love you. But you see, what's revealed here is the love of God to us is without strings attached. It is not dependent upon our loving him. You see, he loved us even when we were far away from him, still sinners. You see, that is what we call unconditional love. When the prodigal came back, his father didn't go over a list of his son's sins. He didn't say, well, where have you been? How many harlots did you lie with? How much money is in your bag? Do you have any of it left? I want an accounting. No, he didn't say any of that. Instead, he fell on his son's neck and he kissed him. And he said to the servants, kill the fatted calf, put a new robe on him, and a ring on his finger, and new shoes on his feet. Let's have a celebration. Let's rejoice and be merry. Where is the revelation of the Father's love? I can say it is, this is ready. It was his readiness for forgiveness. It was his affectionate kiss. Was it the fatted calf? Was it the robe? Was it the ring and the new shoes? These certainly were expressions of his love, but none of these was the very heart of it. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins, 1 John 4:10. We love him because he first loved us. You see, this is the full revelation that love came when the father could not have real joy until he knew that his son was with him. He brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. Song of Solomon 2:4. You see, the father's joy could not be complete until he was sitting in the banquet hall with his son, and he had made sure that the boy knew that he was forgiven and his sins were wiped clean. If you were to look into the window at that moment, you would have seen a young man who had just come into a true revelation of God's love. He would have been dancing. There was music. There was laughter. He was happy. His father was glad over him, was smiling at him. He wasn't under a cloud of fear. He wasn't listening to the old lies where you're going to go right back to the pig pen, I'm sure. You're unworthy of such love. No, he had accepted his forgiveness. He had obeyed his father's word to come in and take for himself all that he needed. He heard his father whisper to him, all that I have is yours. There's no need for you to ever hunger again. You never need to be lonely again. Here, I believe, is the fullness of God's love. I believe it's the very heart of it. It is that even in our darkest times, are you listening to me? God not only embraces us and brings us back, but he also says, bring forth the fatted calf. Let us eat and be merry. In my banqueting house there is a feast of plenty for my loved one. Today we have an even better promise. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly, above all that we would even ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Ephesians 3:19-20. You see, here is God's love. I offer you exceeding abundant fullness, provisions for every crisis, joy throughout your entire life. You can come to the storehouse and claim it all anytime you need it. And now the older son was out in the field. He was hard at work in his father's business. Suddenly, he heard music, laughter, and dancing. When he came near the house, he discovered it was all a feast for his wayward brother. You know, the one who had wasted his father's substance on harlots and riotous living. As the older son looked through the window, he saw his father rejoicing over his younger brother, full of delight. And he couldn't understand how his no good brother could get so free and happy and blessed in such a short time. And the scripture says he was angry and would not go in. Luke 15:28. Finally, the father came out and he urged him to come in. But the older son said, "Lo, these many years do I have served thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment. Yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends." Verse 29. What he was saying is, this is not right. All these years I've served you well and I never disobeyed you at any time. How many of us could relate to that older brother? We spent years trying so hard to please the Lord, living in dogged determination always to do right. And that certainly would describe many of us this morning. I've often been caught on the outside looking in. You see, I've known the Lord all my life. I was never in the world, you might say. I never smoked a cigarette. I never touched a beer or a drug. Never lived in adultery. I worked hard to live for the Lord. There's times I would see new converts come home to Jesus, one who had lived in sin. And when he came, and suddenly he was dancing, rejoicing, happy, and carefree. Yet I sat back thinking, sure, he's singing and praising now, but is he really holy? That's really not for me to decide, is it? It really isn't any of our business whether he's holy. And we say, I paid a price for my place in God. I've served him these many years. I have burdens and I have cares. And at times I felt guilt and confusion. And here this one comes in dancing. He walks in and passes me up with simple faith in God's word. Lord, it's just not right. He is so free and my life is so complicated. Does that sound familiar? Sound like we could identify with that older son? The older son, in all his years of service, had never known true gladness because he had never taken advantage of his father's invitation to appropriate all that he ever needed. You see, I believe the older boy went right back to his lowly shepherd's shack, thinking of one day when he would have his inheritance, thinking, just wait one day. After death does its work, I'll come into great blessing. I'll have a great storehouse. This is the one who's waiting to get to heaven before appropriating, you see, all the good things of God. His father must have been heartbroken. And I believe he had probably told his son over and over, "Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine." Verse 31. In other words, you have been with me all these years, and all I've owned has been yours for the asking. You know I would have given you anything, yet you did not come and lay hold of it. And so I ask you, how many years have you been on the outside looking in? You have a father who has been laying up a great treasure of provisions for you, and yet you have left it there unclaimed. And see, the parable goes on to say that by going in and enjoying the father's treasures, the son had it both ways. He lived his earthly life with the abundant forgiveness of joy and peace and rest that were his, and when death brought him into the inheritance, he also enjoyed what he had already been enjoying on earth. And so that brings me to the heart of my message again. The greater sin was committed by the older brother. How many years did I think it was the younger brother that committed the greater sin? But the greater sin was committed by the older brother. The one who stayed home, worked obediently, and never failed his father. Is it a sin to waste our father's substance on sensual living and a runaway spirit? Absolutely. But it's even a greater sin to rebuff God's great love for us, to leave unclaimed the bountiful resources he gave to us that cost him such a great, great price. Cost him his son. And he wants you to enjoy those riches that cost him his son. So what do you think? Is it not the greater sin of the older? And lastly, I'm closing with this. The runaway son was not chastised. He wasn't rebuked. He wasn't reminded of his sin. Because God would not allow sin to be the focus of his restoration. There had been true repentance and there was godly sorrow. And it was time to move on to the banquet, to the feast. The father said to the older son, he was lost, but now he is in the house again. He is forgiven, and it's time to rejoice and be happy. Are you tired of living like a pauper this morning when you've been provided everything you need? Perhaps your focus is wrong. You tend to dwell on your weaknesses and temptations and your past failures. And when you look inside your heart, what you see discourages you. And then you allow guilt to seep in. You are one to be looking to Jesus as the author and finisher of your faith. When Satan comes and he points at some weaknesses in your heart, you have every right to say, my God has already knows all about it, and he still loves me. He has given me everything I need to get victory and to keep it. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things, 1 John 3:20. He knows all about you, and he still loves you enough to say, come on in and get all that you need. The storehouse is open. The doors to his storehouse are wide open. His riches are full to overflowing. And he urges you to come boldly to the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need, Hebrews 4:16. So come boldly to his throne and ask largely for all the grace and mercy you need to see you through your temptation and trial. Because you know the devil has a million ways to make you feel guilty, to make you fearful, to make you feel condemned, to make you feel confused. He'll tell you you feel this way because you've got junk in your heart. But you see, I stopped looking in my heart a long time ago because it's always black. But it is white to my Heavenly Father because he has covered it with the blood of the Lamb. It doesn't matter how you feel. Jesus has wiped your slate clean. Remind God that it was his idea for you to come in. It was he who invited you in, saying, all I have is yours. Come and get it. Take God at his word. The Bible says everything he has for us is obtained by faith. You need only to say in faith, Lord Jesus, flood me with your peace because you said it is mine and I claim rest for my soul. You can't work it up. You can't sing it down. You can't praise it up. It comes from being rooted and grounded in a revelation of God's love. It comes not in a feeling, but it comes in the word that he has spoken to us. My house is a bread and enough to spare. And finally, God's word can hammer all your fear and your guilt and condemnation to pieces. You can say, let the devil come at me with his lies. My Father knows it already. He has forgiven me. He has cleansed me. There is no guilt or condemnation toward me because I am free. And I believe if you ask the Spirit right now to help you to seize this truth, you can be rooted and grounded in it, every head bowed, every eye closed. The coming days are going to be the greatest that you have ever had. You can say, Lord Jesus, I know I'm going to make mistakes, but nothing is going to shake me because you have everything I need to get the victory and to live in it. So come into his storehouse and claim all that is yours from your loving and heavenly Father. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, thank you for this.